You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Joe DeVito joins us. Hysterical comedian. You've seen him on The Late Late Show. Comedy Central's Live at Gotham. He was a semifinalist on Last Comic Standing. You've seen him on Chelsea Lately, Headline News, CNN, Animal Planet's Wild 100. He's a regular guest on Fox News' Red Eye. You were just on Kennedy's show. You're going to be on Greg Gutfeld's show this Saturday on Fox News. We're going to hold your feet to the fire on that one, try to talk you out of it. But more importantly, he has an album called First Date with Joe DeVito. Enjoy the soothing sounds of Joe DeVito's incredibly funny comedy by going to joedevito.com and ordering First Date with Joe DeVito. This is your first album, and I would assume you talk about dating.
I do, and thank you. I should hang up now. Just everything was in that introduction, David.
Everything.
Yeah, it was really worth the previous 16 attempts it took for you to get that correctly.
Well,
there were a couple of run-throughs you did where I hope you were also squeezing a medical alert device while you were talking, because I didn't think you were going to make it. It was touch and go.
It's first thing in the morning, and Alex Brazell isn't here. And usually he presses the buttons.
Mm.
And it's kind of sad to see me trying to figure out where the record button is. Joe DeVito, you are a very funny guy. Do you mind if I call you the Italian Andy Kindler?
I would consider it a tremendous compliment.
Okay. It's kind of like talking to an Italian Andy Kindler. How close are you to Andy? I know you opened for him.
We talk every now and then. You know, unfortunately, I haven't talked in a while, but he, we had the same management, and he was one of those people I was excited to meet, I think, in Montreal like 10 years ago. And he's someone I can call with a question every now and then, and it's always fun when I get to work with him, because you know what he's like. Just talking to him in the green room, mm-hmm. It just cracks you up.
Now, give me an example of a question you would call Andy for. Maybe I could answer it. When's the last time you talked to Andy? What did you ask him? And maybe I could have answered it for you.
Well, you know, it usually follows the same pattern that I ask him some question about how to get ahead in the business. And then as soon as the words come out of my mouth, he and I both realize he's really the wrong person to be asking that question.
He's gotten ahead in the business the wrong way.
He has. Like, I think a more appropriate question would be something where I just keep saying the word niche. Like, how do I get the smallest possible niche for my audience? But, yeah, Andy was someone, like, I think that right after when I did Last Comic Standing, it's so funny because they get you so hyped up, and I'm not a hyped up kind of person. And then when you don't make it to the finals, they just sort of send you to the airport to go home. And I called him, and I was like, geez, you know, I'm kind of depressed, and I feel like maybe I blew it. And Andy was like, hey, these things come and go. You're funny, and it's all going to be good. So that, you know, that was really what I needed to hear at the time, and it was a big help.
We're all Mickey Rooney's ex-wife. We all go into it thinking, I'll be the one. That show business is going to change this time. I can bend her or him to my ways because I'm David Feldman. And then after the honeymoon, you realize Mickey's not changing. Elizabeth Taylor is not changing. Do you believe you can change the system? I keep thinking that I'm better than the system. The system is corrupt, and the system needs me to purify it. Do you think you can clench your fist, stomp your feet, and change the system?
No, not at all. And the older I get, the thing that's truly tragic is that not only can I not change the system, but you're right, there are times when you think, oh, I'm so much better than this, and then you realize, oh, I'm just not good at this. I feel like now I'm actually in the midst of a midlife crisis, which is something I used to sneer at people for, and I think, wow, I'm close to getting a convertible at this point. If only it could be solved with a hairpiece, you know what I mean? So, but what I do think is encouraging now is that systems of all kinds, we're finding more and more ways around them, and that's good news.
When I was getting my hair plugs, there was a period where I had to get a toupee to mm-hmm. do TV, and they call them systems. They call them hair systems. I don't know if this means anything. They found that toupees didn't fall off the tongue the way a hair system did, or a hair weave, or a hair weave. But
or a process, or a method.
Yeah, but they...
Polyfuse method.
Yeah, they literally came into the waiting room where I was, and they said, this is not a toupee, it's a hair system. And I'd say, it looks like a toupee to me. And they go, no, this is a system. They were insisting that it's a system as though that's a positive thing.
Yeah, right? Like it's an algorithm of some type.
Uh-huh. So there is a system to everything. There's biology, which you cannot change. You're dating, right? You're dating. You're always dating.
I am.
You've never been married. Is that correct?
Never.
And that's a system. Marriage is a system. And you can't buck the system because the relationship is dictated by the norms.
I think so. And I think maybe you have a choice of deciding not to play the game. But once you're in there, I think of some women I know who were so down on marriage and had such contempt for their friends. And then when they got the big engagement ring, they couldn't wait to show everybody, and they were sort of disgusted with themselves that they felt that way, but they were like, I really want to show off this rock.
And you think they're better than that?
Yeah, they thought they were better than that. And then when they were in that position, they were like, yeah, sign me up.
Is that biological or is it cultural? Are they taught, are they trained by De Beers to think this way? I know that De Beers created the mythology of the wedding ring, and that there's actually no shortage of diamonds, that diamonds are way overpriced. There's an overabundance of diamonds, but the De Beers family has created their own shortage. That's true. And up until about 100 years ago, nobody gave a diamond ring for an engagement.
Yeah, it's another one of these silly social contract things we have. But, you know, whenever I start to worry about that, I always think if you take a $1 bill and a $100 bill and you hold them up, they're both pieces of paper with pictures and numbers on them, and they have no... One is not more valuable than the other intrinsically, but it's only because we believe one is more important and worth more that it works. So it goes to show you, like, the moment we stop believing, everything comes crashing down. So we're all invested in this group delusion.
You're right. And dating is that, too. You just went out on a date. So you date a lot.
I just went through that breakup where if nothing else I got out of it was a couple months from not worrying about looking for someone, which it's just so tedious. And then I'm getting older, and last night I'm out with this woman, and the date's going well, but my back started bothering me during the day, and when we're sitting there, I realized my back has gone out. So, but I'm trying to convince myself that I'm still this young, virile, but I couldn't move. So it's embarrassing. Like, I got up to use the bathroom, and I had to do this reverse crab walk and not acknowledge it. And she even said to me, are you all right? Like, I'm backing away from her through this restaurant. So what could I say? She's like, are you okay? And I was like, I just can't take my eyes off of you. Which is why I've just walked ass backward into a waiter.
So you go to the bathroom. What restaurant is that? What restaurant?
It was a new sushi place right next to Gotham Comedy Club.
Oh, I know that place. I know that. Yeah. Oso's.
Pretty good.
They have one of those pull-down toilets behind there. I keep back pain medicine in this. I'm doing a Godfather thing where you go to the bathroom to pull out back pain medicine. I've had David Juskow on, and I just want him to be my sidekick as Vito Andolini. It's an obsession that is destroying my show. So, okay,
that's
so
another one of the great scenes.
You come back from the bathroom, and how's your back?
Not good, because if you were to see me, if you see me walking towards you, my shoulders are easily 6 inches off my hips. So that's how I knew I had a problem, because that morning I looked in the mirror and I said, hey, isn't my navel usually in the middle? So, you know what it looked like? Have you ever seen when a pug runs, how their legs don't line up with the front? That's what I look like. So this is a woman watching a man walk toward her like a jogging pug. And in my mind, I'm thinking, she's going to have sex with this person. She's going to have me on top of her with my legs and upper body completely out of alignment with each other. If you could, I know this is a grim image. Imagine our upper bodies connected in the act of love, but from the waist down, both my legs are outside of her legs.
The beast with one good back, I think is what... That's, the Elizabethans would call it that. The beast with one good back. Do women... Oh, boy, I'm going to get into trouble. There are two conversations that are going on now in America. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I want to go down this path. There's the conversation that men have when they don't think they're being taped or there are no women around. And then there's mm-hmm. the conversation that men have. I think that's always been the case, but that conversation has certainly changed ever since my divorce started. I think my divorce triggered something throughout.
Do you believe it started a national conversation?
I do. I think everything changed in 2012. I think women were awakened. I'll shut up. By the way, that's the new name of this show. I'll shut up. But I do think that in 2012, there was an earthquake, like fifth wave feminism, and they all decided something. Do you believe that? Or did you see some kind of change?
I think there's a couple of things going on. I think in terms of that private conversation that men used to have with each other, it's never been easier to get caught on recording than mm-hmm. it is now. So I think there's an awareness now that you just have to be careful with that, because not only will you get busted because someone's recorded it, but it can be broadcast to the entire world. Mm-hmm. You can make some dumb offhand comment in a tweet and then lose your job. Whereas, I remember when I was young, the only concern you had was the day the high school yearbook came out, was that hopefully I don't look stupid in a photo. And if you survived that day, you were good for another year. But it's, as far as what men say with each other and what they say in the public sphere, look, let's face the facts. You talk a certain way to a certain audience, and when you have your guard down, you speak a different way. Ideally, those two parts of your life are at least in sync. But if we're going to say there's a private you and a public view, and if you have a problem with that, then why does makeup exist?
If you're not
concerned about that, then there should be no such thing as makeup. I mean, it's really painting yourself to look a way that you're not.
It's the same reason I wear high heels. It makes me feel beautiful.
Well, I think you have a finely turned ankle. And I think it would be a shame to not let us know about that.
There's a time and a place for makeup and a time and a place for shaving. I'm talking about me. There's a time and a place to look civil.
Are you specifically referring to Pride Week celebrations that you're preparing for? Look, there's a time and a place for falsies. And some sort of tucking device.
Well, if you were on a first date, mm-hmm. the conversation is going to be different than the second date and the third date. And it's a game, and you both know you're playing a game. Unfortunately, at our age, it's a different game because you both know you're playing the game. Whereas when you're, in your teens and early 20s, you are trying to learn the game, and if you're too good at the game, that's suspect. You're not supposed to be good at the game in your 20s. Otherwise, there's a dishonesty there. But at our age, you're supposed to be pretty good at the game, but the game keeps changing.
Well, first of all, I object to you saying at our age because I am 23 years old.
I know. I know.
It's true. It's true. And I think it's interesting because as you get older, you think you learn more about how these things work, or at least you become conscious of it. To me, the saddest part is when you see grown men like us who they're completely unaware of the game. And who's calling me now? Let me hang this up. Stop.
It's Joe Rogan. It's Joe Rogan. Take the call. He's got a much bigger audience. Talks about
look, it. NBC. Told you not to bother me when I'm... So, Frank, can't you see we're eating here? All right. So...
I love that story. Tell that story. Okay, so Don Rickles is on his first date with a woman.
Yes, he was on a first date.
And he
wanted to make a good impression, and he said to Frank, look, it would mean so much if you just came over and said a quick hello. I know you don't usually like to do things like that, but it would be so impressive. And Sinatra, of course, said he would, and when he came over and said, hey, Don, how's it going? Rickles said, Frank, can't you see we're eating here? And he was probably the only person in the world who could have done that without Sinatra having him beaten.
Uh-huh. You and I are on a first date. We met on BJ Date. You've heard of J Date?
Yes.
This is BJ Date. This is...
It's such the cut to the chase.
It's cut to the chase. It's the two Jewish women who have an affinity for oral sex. All right, we're going to do this in a second. Three things. One is... I once gave Sarah Silverman a joke about women not liking to perform oral sex, Jewish women. And she goes, I'm not going to do that. That's not true. Jewish women invented sex. And I went, okay, fair enough. There is this mythology about Jewish women being bad in bed. And I do a joke, if Bill Cosby likes his women so lifeless during sex, why didn't he go on J-Date? It's not true. You know, Jewish women are insane. Well, anyway, insane.
Well, I found it
as all women
are. As someone who grew up Catholic, the first time I encountered Jewish women who were unencumbered by that kind of Catholic sexual guilt, it was shocking to me that, wow, they're so much more alive than, you know, Molly O'Brien that I know from my Jesuit college who's wearing 15 turtlenecks. I don't even know if I'm feeling up the correct orientation of her body. I may have just been rubbing her back all this time. So that was kind of interesting to me that they didn't have that that Catholic guilt. Because the Catholic guilt thing, it's very hard to shake.
Yes, but we're trafficking in stereotypes.
My favorite kind of human trafficking.
You should do that in your act, by the way.
What's that?
The My favorite kind of human trafficking. That's a great line. Let me just reconnoiter here. And that's a good Jerry Lewis word. Reconnoiter.
Reconnoiter.
Yeah. I think guilt makes for great sex.
Yeah, because there's something at stake in a way.
I mean, the bonobos. You've had sex with a bonobo, right?
I found them generous and giving. You know what? The thing with the monkey sex is I really have an issue with the females' asses swelling when they're in estrus. I know it saves everybody a lot of time. It's an unambiguous sign. But every time I see it, I think my first impression is, what's wrong with this poor monkey? And then you realize they're, I don't know. You know, I know the bonobos, it just seems to lack passion. What else can I tell you?
Well, it's like a handshake to them. It's the sex is disposable with the bonobos. They just they resolve all issues through sex. It's hey, how are you? Wham, bam, and that's over. If I have to choose between a bonobo and a Catholic girl, I'll pick the Catholic girl over the bonobo because she's repressed.
Yeah, so often that is the choice too. I guess here's me as a bonobo. Hey, I thought we had something. That would be me as a bonobo, unable to appreciate the moment. You let just anyone groom lice from you? I thought we had a connection here.
Okay. Do you know anybody who can do anything in the business? Why don't we pitch this as a cartoon? You as a bonobo. This is a great idea for a cartoon. Mm. Joe DeVito is this nerdy bonobo who can't get laid. He wants a relationship. And he's surrounded by all these bonobos. It's the 70s. It's basically you in the 70s where everybody's having sex. And you're a neurotic bonobo. Go pitch.
That's a good idea. Because for me, any cartoon thing is just whatever you have with glasses on it. To be a protozoa with a glass. Oh, that's clearly Joe DeVito.
I'm being serious here. Are you looking I'm being serious. Are you looking to pitch any ideas? Because I'm tired and I can't deal with it. When it comes to going into the Bauhaus glass buildings with the people in their suits, I can't do it anymore. Because they never say yes to me. And then I get angry. Yeah. Mm. If you're looking...
I should. I was never good at stuff like that. I found... Because they say when you pitch things, you want to start from this position of strength. And I found my tendency was to open with something like, look, I need this.
Right.
And that really does not, it doesn't tickle them.
All right, I'm like going to, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to send this to right now. This is how I get these out of my system. And then he'll say no. Let's see here. Idea. A neurotic bonobo monkey. With glasses.
And then just attach my photo.
Who's into long-term relationships. Cartoon. This way, it gets out of our system. He'll tell me why.
Well, don't leave me high and dry.
Hang on, I'm saying cartoon starring.
Yeah, I like the sound of that.
Andy Kindler. Now, let's see. This way he'll say no. A neurotic bonobo monkey with glasses is into long-term relationships starring Joe DeVito. Boom. Then he'll just send me back. He'll go, who's Joe DeVito? And then I'll send him.
Yeah.
Anyway. All right.
And you'll send him my website, and then he'll get a message that says 404 link, bad link.
No, I think that, you know... I wish I owned all of show business, because if I owned all of show business, I would say to Joe DeVito, you're a bonobo monkey. The way you were talking just now about being a neurotic bonobo, we're going to bring in, are Hanna-Barbera still alive? How about Walt Disney? Is Fleischman, is he still making, is iWorks alive?
I don't know. I'll have to check the credits of Steamboat Willie to see if he's still available.
Boy, that's such a great idea for a cartoon, though. Now, most people may not know that bonobos have no hang-ups when it comes to sex, right?
Yeah. Yeah, they go for it.
They just go for it.
But is that... You know, I think we're anthropomorphized, however you say that word, anthropomorphizing something. But you can't say a monkey doesn't have any hang-ups if the idea of a monkey with hang-ups doesn't exist.
I think there are monkeys who are... Well, aren't they monogamous? Isn't it a power thing where you can't have this female because I'm bigger than you?
Yeah, there's definitely the alpha male social structure. And I, you know me with my enjoyment of listening to evolutionary biology lectures. I was listening to one of these guys that I like, and he was saying how you have a strict hierarchy with this kind of monkey he was talking about, and you have the number one guy and then two, three, four, and five, and everybody lords over the guy behind them. So they experimented with, if we gave injections of testosterone to like three and four and five, would they challenge the number one? And they didn't. What it did was it made them beat the shit out of the guy below them even worse. So they didn't. They gave them this extra testosterone, and they just became even bigger jerks to the guys behind them.
Wait a second. You gave the testosterone to the alpha monkey?
No, you gave it to the guys behind him. So what they were thinking was, okay, if we take guys ranked three and four and we pump them full of juice, are they going to try and overthrow the guys above them? But they still recognize the hierarchy. They just made life worse for the guys who were already behind them.
They recognize the hierarchy because it has nothing to do with chemicals. It's intelligence. It's size. It's what?
I think it's just they didn't challenge it. They saw it as the roles they play. I think it's when you see people are rude to, like, supermarket clerks.
Mm-hmm.
I used to work with a woman who was like that, that anyone who waited on her, she was terrible to them. And that was her way of getting even with perceived slights from people above her, was right. She would be obnoxious to people who were, in terms of the status quo, were lower than her and couldn't tell her to go scratch. And I was mortified when she did that because that really bothers me. Like, when I see someone who will just relate to, like, a janitor, somebody like that, as if the people aren't even human, that really mm-hmm. bothers me.
Right. Me too. So when I walk in Manhattan, I'll see a dog, and I'll watch the dog, mm-hmm. and then I'll pretend I'm seeing the world through the dog's eyes, and the mm-hmm. dog is like the Terminator. Right? He's assessing smells and colors and people constantly. He's just looking around. Is he a threat? Are you a threat? Oh, Molly was here. Are you a threat? Are you a threat? Oh, Betty stopped by. Yeah. This tree smells like Betty. When you're in Manhattan and you're walking around mm-hmm. the city, you're constantly, subconsciously assessing our place in the chain.
That makes sense. And that's a good way to put it, because that's the kind of thing that's made me more sympathetic to tourists who are walking around staring at the tops of buildings and getting in the way and all that. And it used to make me really angry. But what I've realized is if you grow up somewhere where you're just not getting a lot of stimulation around you, and then you come to New York and the sheer volume of noises and people touching you and smells, like they just haven't developed the neural pathways to handle that. So I try to be more sympathetic that they're not dumb and that they just don't have the equipment yet to process this. Whereas it's kind of like my driving in New York theory that it works if everyone drives like an asshole. But the moment someone decides to be kind or conscientious, everybody starts banging into each other because it interrupts the flow of the hostility that we share with each other. And that system works.
You need to drive like a lunatic. And the mm-hmm. one person who drives normally and obeys the speed limit screws everything up.
Absolutely.
Okay, so when I talk to my shrink, mm-hmm. I say, I'm the guy who's righteous. I'm the guy who's driving at the speed limit, and people resent me because mm-hmm. I remind them that they're immoral, that they're thieves, that they're breaking the rules. Do you think I'm paranoid, or do you think that there are people who do obey the law, who pay their taxes, and everybody tries to destroy that person because if you don't have somebody who reminds you how immoral you are, then you're not immoral. I guess I'm saying I'm Jesus.
Yeah, I was going to say, let's step off the cross here, Feldman, please. Yeah, I don't think you're paranoid. I think you're self-important and delusional.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's interesting because in New York that I understand what you're saying, that you think, well, look, damn all these people. I've got a moral code I'm going to stick to, and there's a reason why there are rules that you don't cut people off and stuff like that. But I don't think the person is even aware enough to look at you and think, wow, what a mirror he's holding up to society. I think they look at you and they're like, look at this chump. Like, they don't look at you as a beacon. They look at you as like, look at this dope. It's kind of like the flip side that I'm sure when you've gone to the Midwest and towns where people just, the culture is everyone is polite and considerate and kind to each other. And I know as a New Yorker, you put me around those people and I think, you give me 2 weeks, I'll be running this place.
Unless it's a different yardstick.
It shows you the role of cultures.
When I moved to San Francisco, I thought I was a sharp New Yorker. And, you know, that for broadcast television, San Francisco was a giant pizza ready to be eaten. Remember that line from Scarface?
Yeah, yeah. That's the edited for TV version of that.
I thought, I'm a New Yorker. San Francisco is a giant pizza waiting to be eaten. They don't want the New Yorker.
Yeah.
There's a whole different style. Where do you think you fit in on the chain of being? Do you think humans say, okay, there's this hierarchy, but if I change the game, there's a different hierarchy. So I'm not going to play this game. I'm going to play this game because it's easier for me. I like this hierarchy because I can rise.
Yeah. Well, as much as we complain about show business, I look at my own life and think, hey, I've got a pretty good scam running here. I mean, I've got soft hands. So
tell me about
physical
it.
Physical labor's out. I know, right? I need to. You can still feel my icy touch. Yeah, I mean, there is something to be said for rejecting some of the expectations on you and finding your own way. But I think a lot of times, I think that was, from my understanding, what brought down the good vibes of the 60s was that once everyone said, yeah, we're all going to do our own thing, you realize that most people's own thing was kind of being a lazy asshole. Mm-hmm. So I guess what I'm saying is most people are not like us in that they're not smart enough to be captains of their own fate. And we need them to do the dirty work we are too lazy and unqualified to do ourselves.
Wow, being a captain of your own fate. I can't even imagine what that would be like. Are there people who believe that? That they get up every morning and think, I have complete and total free will?
Oh, absolutely. And I'll tell you, I met with, you're going to like this, I met with a life coach the other day.
Hmm.
And it's a woman I'd met at a show, and we talked, and she sounded like she was making a lot of sense. And I told her about some of the stuff I'm going through, and she's like, you don't need to do that. Meet with me for this life coaching stuff. And it was really kind of, it was very eye-opening, because we sat there, and like you said, she said to me, it's just a different mindset. She said, imagine if the happiest you've ever been, if you could wake up every day and feel like that, and not be dependent on anyone else, and you could feel like that every minute of every day. And when she said that, my first thought was, is she charging me for this? Or is this gratis? Because we didn't talk about it beforehand. So that shows you how, even in the face of unrelenting positivity, I can still dig out a nugget of shittiness for myself to enjoy.
Okay, hang on for 1 second. So she's telling you, and you're saying, in order to be the captain of your own fate, you have to wake up and be your own person. And yet, we are told that we're half a human until we are with another human. That in order for us to be fulfilled, we have to be in love and dependent on somebody else. So it's mixed messages.
It certainly is. And, you know, it's tough because it's hard not to become cynical.
Well, what's the answer? I was in a 30-year relationship.
Mm.
And I was told, you're too dependent on one another. You need your independence. That will bring happiness. So everybody became independent and we're both alone. That's not good. Whatever you have, they tell you, you need the other thing. If you're in a relationship, you're codependent. If you're not in a relationship, you're all alone. How do you win at this? You can't win.
You can't, because independent, you know who was independent? Tom Hanks in Castaway was independent, and he ended up having sex with a volleyball. So you really can't win.
I think Wilson and Tom Hanks probably got sick of one another.
I think there was probably times where that handprint face, he turned it away from himself. Just to say, look, I realize you're technically sporting goods, but I need me time. Trust me, if you had an entire island to yourself, I don't care if you were talking to a rock, a tennis ball, a lacrosse stick, there's definitely going to come a moment where you're going to look at it and say, you know what, fuck you, all right? I don't need this shit.
Oh, my God.
You think you're the only one who doesn't need to be full of air?
That's so great. So how did the date end, if you don't mind my asking?
The date ended well. I mean, I don't know. We'll see. I think I'm still pretty raw from the recent breakup, but this young lady seems very nice. Again, she's quite a bit younger, so I may be setting myself up for something that I'm, you know, that could be troubles of its own. But we
How many years younger? Do you mind if I ask?
Disgusting. She's 22 years younger than me.
Hmm.
Yeah. What nerve I have.
She's 22 years younger. Go ahead.
Yeah. Yeah. But she's real cute.
But she's just, real. Hang on for a minute. She's 22 years older. But
yeah, no one's 22 years older than me. They're all dead.
But she's real cute.
I know. Like, that's a mitigating thing. Oh, I know she's a lot younger, but hear me out. What a shock. You mean to tell me she's younger and her skin is perfect? Well, I never would have put those two together.
What about a woman? You know what about a woman your age?
What about a woman my age? Women my age are not interested. Well, some of them are, but I think it's... I just know from living on Long Island that these women, I'll say things like, look, I want someone I can relate to and common experiences. And they're like, look, do you have a boat or not? It's a yes or no question. And I tell them I don't have a boat, but what I do have is an exceptional heart.
They can get that from their girlfriends. They need a boat.
Yeah.
They don't need...
And a rental.
Yeah. They do not need... Women are a... Oh, God. I've got to watch what I'm saying here.
Mm.
Well, if we were characters in a sitcom...
Yeah.
And we were...
By the way, who greenlit that one? They're looking for work. What's the name of the sitcom? Blackballed?
Oh my God. Yeah. Wow. Jesus Christ. You're amazing. So you're going out with a younger girl. Where are you in your life? I'm not going to ask you how old you are, but like,
I'm 48.
Okay. And do you know where you are on the journey?
You know what? That's where it's gotten a little scary lately, because I think with this recent thing that I went through, I'm realizing now that it didn't have a whole lot to do with her. It's something that's happening inside of me. But again, with the midlife crisis, I just have become aware that you go through so much of your life thinking, what am I going to do? What am I doing? And you look at it that way. And then one day you think, what have I done? And I feel like I've, you know, not like I'm Lady Macbeth or anything like that. What have I done? But I'm sort of in a mode of looking back and getting kind of reflective. That's stressful because I was never married and I don't have any kids and, you know, I don't have that boat, which apparently is crucial. So, but here's something interesting. You know, when I was on the first time with you and we talked, you know, the breakup was very raw to me then. You know, I try to be respectful of her. There's no reason for me not to. She's a good person. It just didn't work for some, but she listened to the podcast.
She listened to my podcast?
She did, and she sent me a text saying I mentioned that I thought she had been unkind to me.
Oh, boy.
And she said, ouch, I'm sorry if that happened. And then I replied with a question mark. I was like, what's going on here? And she said, well, listen to the podcast. And I said, why are you listening to the podcast with me? And she said, well, because I read your Facebook every day. And I said to her, like, what are you doing? Like, we had 4 months where I poured my heart out and you couldn't get away fast enough. And now, you know, she's saying, well, I still care about you. And I was like, oh, my God, because I don't think she's lying, but I don't know what it means. And it just, it freaked me out. And then I feel bad, too, because... you know, if someone cares about me, I think she's being honest with that. I just don't know what it means when she says it.
Okay, let me unpack this, because there's a lot of...
Yeah, there's a lot there.
This is heavy, and it's freighted, so it's complicated. Mm. So let me ask you the first question. She listens to my podcast?
She listened to that podcast, because I posted it.
Did she mention me during the podcast? Did she like any parts of the podcast?
She did say, she said, I listened to you on the David Feldman podcast. Who was that other guy who kept interrupting? No, she didn't say anything about you.
Hang on for 1 second. Is she doing all her Amazon shopping via my website? So
She did not mention you being an affiliate.
So did she break up with you? Do you mind if I ask you this question?
Yeah, she broke it off with me. Oh, no doubt about that.
So she broke it off with you.
Yeah.
And now she's having breakup remorse.
I don't think that's it. I think it's that she, you know, we were friends for a long time. I hate to even say were, because I hope someday that will change. That we'll, you know, it won't be like it was before, but I think she feels some guilt. I don't think she intended to harm me. But she didn't said stuff that I'll stand by that, that looking back was like, you got to remember you're talking to another person sometimes. And she would kind of go back and forth between, she would be really uncommunicative, and then she would say something that was so blunt that it almost knocked me over sometimes. So,
mm-hmm.
And I think also, I don't think she has, certainly doesn't have any sort of devious plan that she's trying to stir me up. Because I've been with women like that, where they push away, and then just when they feel like you've healed up, they come in to muck around a little bit. I definitely don't think it's that. I think she doesn't know what to do.
I just, I couldn't figure out women. I fell in love with one woman. I said, okay, that's taken care of. This is my job for life. I'll get a gold watch at the end. I am done figuring out my mother, my sisters, my aunts, all the other. This is it. One woman, and, you know, and my daughter. I remember one of my sons very early on complained to me about his sister. He said, what's up with her? She just, welcome to my world.
Yeah.
He couldn't figure out his sister. And I said, I don't know. I ask your mother. I cannot figure.
Yeah.
The thing I don't understand about women, and no offense. Mm-hmm. Well, I'll say it about me. Why would any woman want to spend time with us? So, like, I cannot imagine. I'm no offense. Because I think, by the way, I think you're one of the funniest people I've ever met in my life.
Oh, stop.
I'm serious. I'm serious. I'm going to send you a transcript of the raw edit because I think you came up with like 20 bits and a cartoon. I think.
Well, just once you get this down to a tight 90 seconds.
That being said, you're very funny. The idea of going to dinner with you and putting on a dress and earrings and trying to impress you. And not eating too much, being polite, and wanting to bring you back to meet my parents for their approval.
Yeah,
I don't get it. Why would anybody want to have sex with you, care about your feelings, be interested in anything other than your sense of humor? I don't understand women. I don't understand why any woman would go out with me. Why would any woman be interested in what I have to say? So it's
all those questions you asked, if you want me to put you in touch with someone who came to a definite answer on that, I can give you an email.
Hang on.
Who decided, I don't think I want to.
Wrote back, like a parody of ants. Yeah. I guess that's a rejection. I guess it was done already.
Not the way I'm going to do it, baby.
Is it too much like ants?
Was that the one with Woody Allen in it?
Yeah. See, now I feel better. Now I feel better. I wrote back, thank you. All it takes is to be rejected by somebody who's funny and knows the business. And then I go, okay, it's been done.
Yeah, it's getting rejected by a schmuck that stings.
Right. He just says, nope, not going to work. And then I go,
by the way, getting rejected by a schmuck, also known as life.
But what about hang on, now maybe this is an interesting way to make money. Mm-hmm. You know, like Shark Tank, where you pitch money-making ideas and you compete to get the investment? What about we have like a Shark Tank of really qualified, smart people, like Robert Smigel, Steve Martin, Marty Short, Lauren Michaels, and creative people pitch ideas knowing that they're never going to get made? That's the agreement, but you are told why it's never going to get made by people who've been in the business long enough to tell you, even if we made it, you'd be unhappy. Because it would be, that's a funny idea for a television show.
Yeah. because you'd have to get it from the right people. Because I remember when I worked a corporate job, I worked in the creative department for book club companies, and I had agencies and stuff like that. And the marketing people would drive us nuts because they were the completely opposite side of the brain. And you'd be in these meetings with someone who felt like they had to give some sort of feedback to justify why they were drawing a paycheck. And you'd present a design or something like that or some copy. And they would say, yeah, I like that, but make this part green. And you say, like, this, look, there's no reason for that to be green. You're just saying that to have something to say.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't even understand why you're saying that. And you just, day after day, you had to deal with those people. So that's what I think of whenever I see a TV show that's so incredibly bad. Now I think, you know, I wonder if when this started it was pretty good. But then all the people who had to stick their fingers into it, they're the ones who gave us this garbage at the end.
Uh-huh.
It's almost like the opposite of a refining process. Where ideas go through and people contribute and they become shittier as they go along.
Wow. You're amazing. So you're going to be on Greg Gutfeld's show on Fox
yes.
News Saturday night.
Saturday at 10 p.m.
And the name of the show is called The Greg Gutfeld Show.
Greg Gutfeld Show.
Do you know what you're going to talk about?
Don't know. They usually send us the topics the day of. So I'll have some time to collect my thoughts. And I did the show once before, but unfortunately didn't air because of breaking news. But it's pretty cool. There's a live audience. It's different.
Do you think a live audience in comedy might cut into Fox News' credibility?
Well, they're doing these different kinds of shows now.
I was
where,
making a joke. Sorry.
Well, yeah, I know what you're doing.
Thanks.
Well, but you know what happens is that sometimes this would happen with Red Eye was that clips would circulate, but the people watching them didn't know what the show was. And they'd be, why are these people so flippant about the news? This is an important story.
Mm-hmm.
I had one. I was on Kennedy's show. And someone from Times of India watched it, and they could not grasp what the show was. And they pretty much were saying, why is Kennedy from MTV and a comedian? Why are they talking about terrorism? But then when I read the article, I was like, yeah, that's kind of a legitimate point.
Kennedy is a libertarian, right?
Yes.
What's her last name?
And full name is Lisa Kennedy Montgomery.
And she was named after Jack Kennedy, I would assume, or Robert Kennedy.
I would, yeah, I guess right around that time, sure.
And it's interesting that she picked the name Kennedy.
Yeah.
What's that about?
I don't know.
Hang on. They bought our Shark Tank idea. All right. Joe DeVito, DeVito. Go to joedevito.com. Buy his new album, First Date with Joe DeVito. Have you ever been married?
Never. No, never married.
Never married.
Never even close.
First Date with Joe DeVito. Watch him on Greg Gutfeld's show on Fox News. Let me just swallow that for
a
second.
And I'm putting up some more recent video clips for people to enjoy.
Okay.
Started doing that yesterday.
This is how much I respect you and how funny I think you are. I'm actually plugging Greg Gutfeld's show on Fox News. That speaks volumes to how brilliantly funny you are.
Thanks.
Yeah. And you'll come back?
Yeah, absolutely. I love talking to you. And there's always not just a good time, but rather enlightening exchanges we have here.
Yeah, you're amazing. On Twitter.
At Joe DeVito Comedy, and same on Instagram, at Joe DeVito Comedy.
Stand in line for 1 second, sir.
You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.